Welcome to the Open to Hope Show. I'm your host, Dr. Gloria Horsley, with my daughter and co-host,
Dr. Heidi Horsley.
This show is brought to you by the Open to Hope Foundation with a mission of helping people find hope after loss. Well, Heidi, we got a great show today. We got a good show for you. It's on resilience, snapping back. How many people have you had snap out of it, right?
You're scaring me.
Snap out of it. Get over it, right?
Oh, yes, that is definitely a common thing. Get over it. Deal with it. Why are you still grieving? Snap out of it, like you said.
Yeah. But resilience, that's what we're going to talk about. What does that mean, and how can you be resilient? We've got some great people that are going to talk about this today. Because, you know, we all know, you wonder, am I going to get over it? You know, is it going to be okay? Am I resilient? What does that mean?
Right, exactly. And so we have three people today that are resilient, and they didn't start out resilient. They started out, you know, in a very painful, dark place and moved. They're going to talk to us about how they got to where they are today, because mm-hmm. today they are in a very different place than they were when they were first started grieving.
Yeah, because they're amazing. They're inspiring a lot of people to be able to move through their grief journey.
They are. And Mom, they've all been on our show before. We're going to talk with Tanya Lord, Dr. Tanya Lord.
Hi,
and
Tanya.
Right next to her is Annah Elizabeth, mm-hmm. and right next to her is Barbara Hopkinson.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to say a little bit about all of them, because they've all done a lot of things in the grief and loss world. So Dr. Tanya Lord, who we've had on the show many times, and she's fabulous, and she speaks all over the country, and she is the co-founder of the Grief Toolbox. She is the director of patient and family engagement at the Foundation for Healthy Communities in New Hampshire. She does a lot more. She, mm-hmm. like I said, she speaks a lot.
She's my co-author of an article on dealing with a loss in the hospital. So
I love it. And most importantly, she's Noah's mom.
Mm-hmm.
So next to her is Annah Elizabeth, who has also been on our show before. And she is the author of Digging for the Light and the developer of the Five Facets of Healing, and Gavin's mom. And then we have Barbara Hopkinson, who is the founder of A Butterfly's Journey. She is the creator of Faces of Resilience. She has written a book, which we're going to have up there, a new book. And she is doing a lot in the grief and loss world as well, as you'll find out. And your son,
Brent and Robbie.
Brent and Robbie.
A baby.
Oh, you had a baby. Okay.
One miscarriage, and then...
And you've also lost your spouse.
Yeah, I'm a widow as well. I'm a widow, and I've lost three children.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, yeah. Okay. So, and written the well, you know about Faces of Resilience.
Yes.
This is all coming together for me. I've known Barbara for a long time, but I didn't know about her multiple losses.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I know that Tanya's had seven miscarriages, right?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
So,
and I've had two.
And you've had two. Mm-hmm. And I've had two also. Mm-hmm. So, you know, and my mom's got a son that died and parents that have died. So we've all had.
And siblings.
And siblings, yes.
In the last 3 years, I've had a couple of siblings die.
And I know you had Heather, a sibling who was your sister-in-law, but a sibling to you.
Okay, so this is really sad.
Lots of loss. That's why I liked it. It's called resilience snapping back, because if you can come from a place of multiple and numerous losses of people close to you and still end up like these fabulous women, then, you know, it's a lifeline for those of us out there that think we can't do it.
Yeah. And the fact is that having Noah die, how many years has it been?
Four. It'll be 20.
20 years. You know, I think that there's a resilience in knowing that you can handle other loss, too, because you've recently, not too long ago, lost your husband's sister, who was like a sister to you. And do you think that your past losses have made you more resilient?
That's an interesting question. I think that, you know, so when I think of resilience, or when we think about resilience, it's a lot of times equal to, or talked about as if it's an inner strength that we somehow have to build or come up with, and I think, or work towards. But when I look at, and I've been called resilient by a lot of people, and like Heidi said in the introduction, I didn't feel very resilient. But what I found is, for me, resilience is much more about understanding that I can be okay where in whatever situation. So it wasn't about being resilient with Noah and then hoping that life wasn't going to throw me something else. As life continued to throw all kinds of challenges my way, I started to realize that what I needed to do was not trust that life was going to be any better, but that I could be better no matter what life threw at me.
I love that. That's wonderful.
I like that.
Yeah. And tell us about your loss and how you find resilience, Annah Elizabeth.
So my loss basically started with Gavin's death on May 11th of 1990. So he'll be 29 here in a few weeks. And in a seven-year period following his birth, I had two miscarriages in the beginning of the second trimester, three more complicated but successful pregnancies. In the midst of all that, I had a serious breakdown and walked into a behavioral science unit because I thought I was going crazy, and it turned out to be severe depression. And then 6 weeks before my youngest child was born, I discovered that my husband and my best friend were having an affair.
Oh, geez.
So
that's a lot.
For me, I remember distinctly thinking just days in the hospital after Gavin died, that because he died from unexpected delivery complications, that I didn't want to spend a lifetime mourning him. Mm-hmm. I didn't know what that meant, what it looked like on the other side, or how I was ever going to get there, but I knew what I didn't want. And the question that drove me through all of those was, how is it that some people go on to live happy, fulfilled lives following tragedy, while others succumb to drugs, despair, a life avoid, or suicide? And so I chased that question, and obviously in chasing those that question and all the others it spawned, I learned, as Tanya said, over time, that I could be okay no matter what life threw at me. And my work is all about helping people to live with passion, productivity, and purpose, no matter what adversity they encounter in their life. So that's, to me, that's the resilience, is that same piece. It doesn't mean that we feel resilient in the moment, or any new loss makes us less vulnerable. It's just that now we have more tools to be able to, and resources to be able to call upon, and that strength to know, okay, I can do this.
And how about you, Barbara? Talk about your loss. Your son was killed in a motorcycle.
Yeah, so my oldest son. First, I had a miscarriage in 1980. Mm-hmm. And then I had two healthy boys. And when they were 6 and 4, my third son was full-term stillborn, Robbie. Oh. So I had to come home and tell the boys that their little brother was not coming home, which was very difficult. Mm-hmm. And then those two grew up, you know, and everything was great. And my older son was in an requested to go to Army ROTC high school, and then Arizona State University College, and he was they switched vehicles. You know, after their physical training one morning, they were going to breakfast, and he basically talked this young man out of his motorcycle, but it was really too powerful for him, and he lost control of it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that was, of course, a shock, and we had a 6-hour flight to get there. We didn't know. They pronounced him brain dead while we were in the air.
Wow.
And so we had to take him off life support the next day and then go through that whole process. A year later, my 30-year marriage fell apart when my husband left me for a younger woman. Uh-huh. And that, actually, the combination of all of those and his brother, who was then 19 when he was 21, flunked out of college. And I attempted suicide.
No surprise that
you went to college. And you attempted suicide.
Yes, I did.
Wow.
So, but, you know,
did you end up in the hospital?
No, you know, I did it in what was probably a chicken or an easy way. I shouldn't say that. But I drove into the garage. I had an event that day, and something happened to cancel the event, and I needed to be around those people that day. So when I pulled back into my garage, I realized I'd be living alone for the first time. Mm-hmm. I was thinking retirement and grandchildren, you know, right, with my older son, and that went away. My younger son was out of, you know, was flunked out of college, mm-hmm, and I had some issues. I was afraid he was into drugs. He wasn't, but I was afraid he was. And then, you know, with my husband gone, so my life kind of turned upside down pretty quickly. So, but it gave me some time to think, and what I realized was I couldn't do that to my remaining son, mm-hmm, and it was a turning point for me. So it turned into a positive, because it made me say, I have to climb out of this hole one day at a time.
Well, you hit rock bottom, it sounds like.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, the research shows, I did a 9/11 research study for 10 years, and the research shows that if you have three significant traumatic events at the same time,
mm-hmm,
it does cause you to kind of go over the waterfall and feel like, I'm going crazy, I can't take this anymore.
Yeah.
You certainly had that.
Yes, and like I said, I'm just happy that I chose a method that gave me some time to think about it, because
right,
then it became a turning point for me.
Yeah.
So then, you know, I founded a Compassionate Friends chapter, and, you know, I wrote a book, and then I started another nonprofit, and now I've started these photo shoots called Faces of Resilience.
Yes, I love those.
That the mission is to encourage open expression of grief, loss, and love.
We're showing some of those as we speak. And you know what I think is interesting, and I really want to start out with this. When I started working with the 9/11 families right after 9/11, they hated the word resilience. Mm-hmm. They resented it, and they got angry about it. And you touched on that at the beginning.
And strong. You're strong.
Yes.
I don't want to be strong.
They felt like it minimized.
I don't feel strong
yet. Right. They felt like it minimized mm-hmm. what they were dealing with. And they were like, Heidi, we are putting on a mask right now. So I wonder, I mean, you kind of touched on this at the beginning. It sounds like you didn't really mm-hmm. start in resilience. You eventually found that place.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Found. Mm-hmm. I think all of us differently our way to that.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I think there's been some research and some thoughts about, too, that not acting resilient can sometimes make you feel closer to the person. People mm-hmm. are a little bit hesitant to give up the pain.
Right, because the pain represents your connection to the person.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Well, I think for a long time, you know, when you lose a young child, people say...
To a tonsillectomy, by the way.
Yeah, a series of medical errors following a tonsillectomy. But I heard all the time, children shouldn't die, children don't die, this shouldn't have happened. And when I was in that loop of belief structure that this shouldn't have happened, I spent a lot of time not being resilient and not worrying about anything except how to fix that, how to bring Noah back. Because somehow if it shouldn't have happened, then there was a way to make it not have happened. Mm. But once I really realized children do die, the reality is Noah is dead, mm-hmm. and there's nothing I can do about that. Once I stopped trying to fix that, mm-hmm. I was able to then think about what do I do now? And that's what sent me to the work of I couldn't fix Noah, I can't fix mm-hmm. Noah, but maybe I can make it, use what I learned from the experience of medical loss and go into, which now I do work with healthcare to in patient safety, patient family engagement.
So but that's what motivated you to get your PhD.
Right.
And now it sounds like what you're saying also is that you're saving lives. You couldn't save your son's life because that was a medical error, but you can educate and hopefully save other kids from going through the same experience, right?
Well, I think there's that, absolutely. Mm-hmm. But there's also helping other people who have been harmed by healthcare. Mm-hmm. The patient partner innovation community, PPIC online on Facebook, is helping people who have been affected by healthcare and want to give back. And it helps that resilience, it helps the healing to say, okay, the reality is that I can't fix what's happened to me, but going forward, we can make things better.
Yeah. Well, we want to get to you, the other two programs too, besides her program, but let me ask, while we're kind of in mid-show, could you give, there's a time frame, right? We're not going to be suddenly resilient, right? Mm. Could you give, each of you, give some tip and an idea? We'll start with you, Barbara, on what our audience watching, what can they expect the first year, the second year? What do we know about resilience?
I think it's unique. I think it's unique to your unique relationship, your type of loss, your personality. People grieve differently. Like for instance, my husband and I grieve very differently, and that had an effect on our marriage. So it's hard to answer that question, but you have to recognize that you've been through a serious loss, and you need to recognize that there's collateral damage from that. Because it changes your life, it changes relationships, it changes all things. So if you can be patient not only with yourself and be kind to yourself and be patient with each other, I don't think I'd put a time frame on it. I think it very much depends. I mean, it was different for each of my children. And then when I lost my husband suddenly, we were married 11 and a half years, that was my second husband, so, you know, lost him suddenly, and it was different. And somebody said, like, wow, how are you doing that? Are you going to be able to survive that? I said, yeah, because I'm learning. Each time I get a little bit more intelligent about what to do and how to help myself. And I tie it back into my purpose in life.
You look back on your past losses and say, what helped me in the past with a loss? And I'm going to use some of that information to help me in the present.
Yeah, I do. And I really, you know, I don't take it personally. It's not about kind of why me.
Right.
Because these things happen to everybody,
right.
kind of like Tanya said, with, you know, children do die and husbands and wives do die. Mm-hmm. But it just allows you to learn what works for you, right? Because mm-hmm. the idea is keep an open mind, yeah. try a lot of things, yeah. pick three that might help a little bit, and then keep doing those, and then, you know, then you start something else, you know, and just keep trying things.
Right. But okay, how about you, Annah Elizabeth?
One of the things I'll piggyback on what she said is everybody's experiences are different because mm-hmm. they bring different things to the table, different experiences, different beliefs, and different things are happening at the same time. For me, calling on the previous things that worked for me, in some ways it helps and in some ways it doesn't. And one of the things that I found is I had a different experience and I said, well, this worked for me before, I'm going to do it. And I really ended up beating myself up because it wasn't helping this time.
Oh,
and eventually I had to realize that, okay, this is a different experience, a different place and time. So I know that I need something else. So that's when I work with people, I tell them, number one, there is no normal. There are commonalities. There, I heard years ago, and I can't quote it, but sometimes a significant loss can take 8 to 10 years for a person to resolve.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean always, but it can. And what I found in the people that I work with is there tends to be three commonalities, and something that people get hung up on is that the second or the third year, they feel worse than they did in the first year, and they get hung up. So one of the mm-hmm. things that I always tell people is, if you're feeling that way, know that, one, it's okay, and you're not alone in that. The first year, you have that natural shock system where that takes over, and you're, what I say, taking care of business. There's so many legal things sometimes. The second year, that shock is wearing off, and now you face all the firsts. Mm-hmm. And then the third year, people start to realize the finality of it. Mm-hmm. And so when I hear people talking about those things, I say, and then you use the word patient. Please just be patient with yourself and keep reaching out to people you trust.
There are a lot of factors connected to, mm-hmm. I mean, if people are in court, if mm-hmm. there's been, things that delay.
Yeah.
It's complex. But Bethel Vandalkork said something to us on the show we did with him, Heidi. It's been watched by thousands of people, and mm-hmm. you might want to watch it if you're interested in resilience, because he said, we know how to grieve.
Mm-hmm.
Death is part of life.
Yeah.
And we know how to do it. Trust yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah. And I think the whole idea that it's, what the research has shown, 7 to 10 years to really wrap your arms around fully the loss, a lot of it is we've lost our identity.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a personal loss. It's like, who am I without these people in my life?
Mm-hmm.
And we have to, you know, get really comfortable with our new identity.
Yeah. And you know what? It can kind of be some fun things along the journey. You guys were really serious here, but you three are a lot of fun. And we have a lot of fun times together, don't we?
Yeah, we do.
We have.
Yeah,
and it's play is a part of it.
And our loved ones would want us to be having fun.
Yeah, and it's a fun trip. Yeah. And you meet some people that you never thought you'd meet, open the whole
world. Well, some of the most incredible people are the people like you, the three of you, mm-hmm. that are working with people that have lost hope and that are in such bad places and that don't know how they're going to find their way mm-hmm. back. And people say to me, how do you do this work? It's so depressing. I said, no, it's not.
No,
because we all see them ending up in a place where they are in a different space, and hopefully they found hope again. We take the journey with them out of the darkness and back into the light.
But it's also kind of nice to be a beacon of hope.
Yes.
Right?
You guys are our lifelines.
Like, you know, it's okay. You can survive this. You know, it's not hard. It's not fast. It's not easy. But you can survive this.
Okay, Barbara, let's start with you. Okay. Before we close the show, I want to tell people how to find you.
abutterfliesjourney.org, and that's FLYS, plural, not possessive. And then this facesofresilience.org.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And Annah?
The Five Facets of Healing.com. In most of your social media platforms.
Now, let me ask you too, are you doing online counseling? Both of you, are you doing? No. Do you do any?
I am getting ready to roll some of that out.
I just wanted to make sure we got that out. But I know you do go around.
I'm a certified grief recovery specialist, so I do think sometimes over the phone or maybe, you know, online is an extension of that.
Okay, and they can find you online. Tanya, I think it's important for people to know that you actually will go around and speak at hospitals and things if there are people that want to know about hospital medical error. You're certified. You do things for the state of
New Hampshire.
New Hampshire. And how can they find you?
By email is probably the best.
Okay.
T. Lord, at healthynh.org.
And what exactly will you do? Because I know you speak a lot, and you are a professional, and Dr. Tanya Lord goes around and does these things. What exactly will you do, just so that they know?
So really it is about patient engagement and about including the patient perspective in creating a safer healthcare system.
Great. Okay, so before we close the show, I want everybody to give me one thing that people can do to be more resilient.
Be kind to yourself.
Mm-hmm. Trust in yourself really is the first thing that came to my mind, as hard as it is. Just keep calling on the things that have worked for you.
Tanya?
Recognize that even if you don't feel like there are resources for you, that no matter what your situation is, there are external resources and your own internal resources.
Awesome.
Right.
Well, we're going to close the show now, Heidi, with Paul Alexander, a wonderful friend of ours, and he is going to sing Send Me an Angel. And we know that if you've had a loss, you do want to try to call on that angel. So
absolutely,
to help you be more resilient. And we want to thank you for watching this show today. And Heidi and I want to remind you that if you've lost hope, please lean on ours until you find your own. And God bless.
Dear God, can you send me an angel? Dear God, can you send one right now? Can you hear me? How's the connection? Sometimes I get bad reception. Oh, I know life's not so easy, and obstacles get in the way. Dear God, can you send me an angel? Send me an angel today. I've started an angel collection. The figurines hang on the walls. Well, there's two on my desk. I got one on my shoulder. I think there might even be one in the car. Well, I hear they're real good at proclaiming, and good news would suit me just fine. Well, if you don't mind, can one sit by my side? I really could use a friend at this time. Dear God, can you send me an angel? Dear God, can you send one right now? Can you hear me? How's the connection? 'Cause sometimes I get bad reception. Well, I know sometimes life's not too easy, and the obstacles get in the way. Dear God, can you send me an angel? Please send me an angel today. Well, I got me a heavenly choir made of pins, pendants, sculptures, and bears. There are angels of light, health, hope, and caring. Isn't it great? God is so good at sharing. We were taught we all have a guardian who knew us before we were born. Well, there's Raphael, Michael, Gabriel too. They say he's the one blowing the horn. Dear God, can you send me an angel? Dear God, send one right now. Can you hear me? How's the connection? Sometimes I get bad reception. Well, I know life's not so easy, and obstacles get in the way. Dear God, can you send me an angel? Send me an angel today. I could sure use a lift. Can you spare me some wings? I'd really be touched if my angel sings. Dear God. send me an angel? God, can you send one right now? Can you hear me? How's the connection? Sometimes I get bad reception. Oh, I know. Sometimes life's not so easy, and those obstacles get in the way. But dear God, can you send me an angel? Send me an angel today. Don't delay, don't delay, don't delay. Send me an angel today.
You don't need enough hope to get through the day. You don't need enough hope to get through a year. You just need enough hope to get through the next moment.
Even though we had this thing happen to us, it also happened for us.
We hold the memories of those that we cared for, that were a part in the making of our characters. And when they pass, those memories will come back when you need them. They become voices of intuition and of guidance.
We want to be a lifeline for somebody else. We want to inspire others and say, we know what it's like to be where you are, but you're not always going to be there. Just take our hand, believe us. We'll take the journey with you.
When life presents 1,000 reasons to mourn, show life that you have 1,001 reasons to smile.
We get through this one breath at a time. We don't do it a day at a time. That's healing. That's positive. And that's what the world wants to talk about.
People die. Love doesn't die.
We always say, if you've lost hope, please lean on ours.
The loss of a loved one can leave you feeling depressed, angry, alone, lost. But you don't have to face this journey on your own. Open to Hope is a free community for anyone who has experienced loss. Find support. Find help. Find hope. Give grief a voice at opentohope.com.